some details. So initially, the patient will have a venous blood gas, and this is done at the laboratory at a hospital only because they have the arterial blood gas machine. It cannot be done through lab for request. Arrangements need to be made with the supervisor of the laboratory if they do not know you and do your testing all the time. So the method of doing a venous blood gas, as per von Arden in an extensively complicated book that Bill Ray referred me to, is that you do the stick in the vein with a no application of a tourniquet. So it's a free-flowing anticubital vein, or I guess a larger vein, but we're not sticking femorals these days anymore. And you would send the blood in a green tube on ice to the laboratory that does the venous or the arterial blood gases. You don't need respiratory to draw it. They don't draw veins. So you just need to tell the lab that it will be accurate if you do it in a green top tube, which is heparinized. So what happens is that the only parameter you're really interested in interpreting the venous blood gas is the PO2. So that should be 25 to 28 as per von Arden. The higher the PO2, the worse the patient is. A lot of normal people are sort of in the 30s and they're walking around in society and they don't realize that they have a little bit of abnormality. And the people who are in the high 30s, 37, 8, 9, they definitely need oxygen therapy, and people in the 40s are quite severe. Sometimes people will have a PO2 in the 50s, 60s, and mine was a 75. So I had a lot of tissue hypoxia as demonstrated by a venous blood gas. And now I'm going to explain what the reasoning is behind knowing that somebody has an abnormality in the blood gas oxygenation, what it's telling you about the patient. So if you've got PO2 of 100 in the artery and it's going out to the fingers, the muscles of the fingers, the normal VBG has a PO2 of 25. So that means about 80 or so, 75 let's say, is being used up by the muscles of the fingers. You can think of it that way. So you're using the oxygen that's being supplied to the distal organ. It could be kidney, it could be brain, any part of the body that's getting oxygen delivered to it by the arterial system. And von Arden describes in great length that you get damage to the cells of the endothelial lining cells of the capillaries. The cells swell, they don't allow oxygen to get out of the capillary or CO2 to get back in, so you have a problem of shunting, that the blood is going around in a circle in the capillary, but it's not really accomplishing the task. And the patient will have tissue hypoxia, could have mitochondrial damage on that basis. And in my case, I had electron microscopy of a muscle biopsy, and that muscle was severely hypoxic, and the cells had anoxic mitochondria. And so that's why, in my case, I had a Lou Gehrig's type picture with damage to the mitochondria leading to muscle weakness and neurologic dysfunction based on tissue hypoxia from, well, what is the cause? The cause is chemicals, mold toxins, which are a chemical, mycotoxins, or other substances in the blood that are basically damaging those endothelial lining cells. Also, at University of Pennsylvania, there was a researcher years ago who had determined that in autism, endothelial damage was often found in the patients. And there are other diseases where endothelial damage is well described. So we want to have easy tests that a doctor can do on patients to determine if oxygen therapy is indicated. Now, sometimes the venous blood gas won't be significant. You'll have a PO2 of 29, and you still want to give the patient the option to see if oxygen makes them feel better. And sometimes they'll open up and perfuse tissues, and a week later, you'll retest after doing intravenous vitamins and maybe some sauna, and, you know, 2 weeks down the line, and the venous blood gas will change because all of the toxins that they've been storing are coming out. They may cause endothelial damage now, and then you need oxygen. The other thing is that oxygen is very useful for treating reactions. So if somebody has a headache, we use it in the emergency room as a standard treatment. And we also have patients who just benefit from oxygen therapy for 10, 20, 30 minutes when they have a reaction to a chemical or an exposure from a food and they just don't feel good. They can use oxygen as one of their numerous treatment modalities to get them out of a reaction, is what they would say. The other thing I wanted to go into is how to do the oxygen, how long, and what are the downsides. So, you know, oxygen shouldn't be used at more than 2 hours a day at 6 liters, maybe 7 or 8 liters if the person ventilates very well and empties the non-rebreather bag. The setup I obtained from Dallas at Dr. Ray's clinic, and it basically is a non-rebreather bag made out of cellophane that's put in a frame that's made out of a wood that's not pine. And they're handmade by somebody in Dallas. And then that is connected by tie-down tubing to a humidification bottle and to the patient. So there are two ports where the tie-down tubing comes out. One goes to the patient, and the patient uses a ceramic mask to breathe the oxygen. And the reason for ceramic is that because the patient is chemically sensitive, plastics are not tolerated well. And the traditional plastic mask will cause a reaction. And within 3 or 4 days, the patient will become sensitized to that plastic and sick from it. So you want to stick with a ceramic mask only, and you put little cellophane flaps, and the patient has a good seal with this mask, and then can ventilate and blow out, and the flaps go up, and then breathe in, and the flaps come down, and then they make a good seal if the mask is fitting their chin and nose well, and then they see the non-rebreather bag crinkle, they hear it crinkle, and they can see it move a little bit, and that tells them that they have a good seal. The idea is to use the oxygen for a couple hours and not to take a break. No bathroom break and no chatting on the phone, because you really, as Von Arden described, want to get the arterial oxygen to a certain level in order to therapeutically affect those endothelial cells and fix them. So there may be other things that help endothelial cells, but oxygen is the treatment, and oxygen is what we're measuring. So it's sort of a coincidence that O2 is the therapy. For all we know, the vitamins may be helping the cells as well, because we're often overlapping and doing the two at the same time over a period of weeks. The other thing is that the humidification bottle is also made in Dallas, and it holds water, which should be freshened up every couple of days, especially in summer heat, because it can fester and grow bacteria. And then the oxygen coming out of an M or an H tank, a large oxygen tank, is going to the water, getting humidified, and then going to the non-rebreather bag, so that the patient is not breathing in dry air, which will give them pulmonary issues and dry nasal mucosa and a dry throat. So you can't really do O2 unless you do it this way. Otherwise, it'll cause trouble. The other thing is that oxygen toxicity can occur if you do more than 2 hours a day. So we all know that 100% oxygen will lead to death if you do it for 24 hours. So you don't play around with O2. It has to be prescribed by a physician. You write down what you want delivered, and usually you get the oxygen from a welding company, and you ask for medical-grade oxygen, and MRH tanks, get two delivered at a time, and you assure them that it's for somebody with chronic fatigue, they don't have any great requirements, they won't cause any trouble, please deliver it, and you don't want the patient to feel that they have to get it from an oxygen company, because they are trying to sell you a concentrator or liquid oxygen, and it really works best if you do M or H tanks. The little E tanks have a different size regulator that won't overlap with the M or the H tank, and they're lined with a polyester. So Dr. Ray felt that the E tanks, which only last 2 hours at this rate, are not appropriate. I mean, you could use it for transportation in the car, but other than that, I would stick with the larger tanks at home. And usually it's $75 to lease a tank for the year, and maybe $50 to $100 per tank, and you can get a couple weeks out of a large tank. So it's really very economical. It's not going to be covered by insurance, don't ask. You don't have an abnormal arterial oxygen, which is what Medicare would require to have oxygen therapy covered. So don't bother. Just pay cash for it. Airgas is a company that supplies tanks nationwide, so you can try them first, if not a welding company. And you just get the Yellow Pages out, make 15 phone calls, and you find who's going to be your supplier, and they either deliver or you can pick them up in a truck every, you know, couple of months. And the other thing I wanted to say is that the venous blood gas can be repeated after 9 days of therapy to see if you're making headway, and the oxygen should improve and go lower. I usually wait a day or two after the last oxygen treatment to do the test, because otherwise you can have an erroneous elevation of the PO2. And I don't know why that is. Dr. Ray didn't know why, but nevertheless, wait at least 36 hours before doing your venous blood gas since the last treatment. Then, if you don't make any headway in the next 9 sessions, you could put the person on an exercise bike, and it could be low tech. They could just do pedaling, or they could do, you know, motion in their bed where they're just exercising to help drive the oxygen in higher, because they're doing aerobic exercise. And when they're moving their muscles, they'll have increased blood flow to all the organs and have enhanced response, usually, to the use of the oxygen. And they obviously can't exercise for a full 2 hours. The other thing is that usually it's 18 days of therapy, as per Von Arden. And if they're in the 40s or 50s, they're probably going to need 36 days of therapy. And obviously, it's an arbitrary number once you get above 18, so you can just sort of do it until you can get the patient to have a better PO2 in the 28 or below range. The other thing is that sometimes this therapy will hold for years, and they won't need to repeat it. But when they start to fall backwards and feel weak, fatigued, or sick, they can repeat the venous blood gas. The other thing I was going to say is that the oxygen therapy could be, enhanced by doing vitamin C at the same time. So you have oxygen, which is a pro-oxidant, and you have the antioxidant effect of low-dose vitamin C, and you sometimes will have an increased utility of the two therapies. I recommend the Von Arden book. It's $150. It's very dense and hard to read for patients. The other thing I was going to say is that when people have darkened limbs from dysautonomia and they have a bluish hue, or you do the blood pressure cuff and the hand forms a claw due to, I think, hypocalcemia, that kind of person really needs oxygen therapy quickly, and there's really no replacement for it. You don't need to do hyperbaric, although hyperbarics could be useful. It's much more expensive, and it can't be done at home. It can't be done in the clinic during therapy. So I would vote for the low-tech, regular oxygen therapy initially, although hyperbarics doesn't really have that much of a downside, except for people who are so chemically sensitive, they can't get into a hyperbaric chamber, and it's leading to claustrophobia and that kind of thing. Let's see what else. The person who can't exercise well, has a lot of fatigue, would benefit, I think, from the use of oxygen therapy, as well as things like carnitine, CoQ10, and magnesium, which will enhance energy production at the cascade, which controls ATP production. So we can go into details, but I'm trying to stick with low-tech, practical things a physician can do. I'm going to give a very short description of sauna therapy. The idea is not to do sauna when you're sick, to take it easy, get well, heal, rest and breathe fresh air, go to the ocean and breathe fresh air, do oxygen therapy, do intravenous saline, intravenous vitamin C, and what we call the works, the other things we add to the vitamin C, and not do sauna until the person is strong enough. I would not do sauna until the person who has adrenal insufficiency is treated with hydrocortisone and other hormones, and until the dysautonomia has been treated with midodrine, florinef, salt, and the appropriate management. Because if you put them into sauna, they'll venodilate, they will have too much tachycardia, they could faint on exiting, and it's just a recipe for disaster. The other thing is that the toxins come out. We will make you more EMF sensitive, more chemically sensitive, likely will not be a good idea on a daily basis at the outset of treatment. What I would say to do is do a 10-minute or 15-minute sauna once, 1 or 2 weeks into treatment, after the person is stabilized, as I mentioned, and then see how they tolerate it. Do they crash the next day? Are they exhausted? Do they feel depressed? Do they have a headache? Then you should not do sauna again until that effect wears off 3 or 4 days later, if it does. Then you could advance the sauna by 5 minutes every third or fourth day, and then slowly move to 3 days a week, 4 or 5 days a week, and then 6 or 7 days a week for about 30 to 60 minutes. They can take breaks in between. The temperature should be 150 to 160. I prefer Heavenly Heat sauna, but I also use Sauna Ray. I like Heavenly Heat because it has rocks and you can add infrared to it. You can sit on the top shelf and be about 160, or you can let it be at 180 and sit on the bottom shelf. But generally, you don't want to go above 160. You want a nice low temperature sauna, and you will become better at sweating as the autonomic nervous system improves. Don't expect to sweat the first time or two, and usually you sweat within 10 minutes. The idea is the sicker you are, the less you're going to sweat. As you start to get better, your body will start to sweat earlier, and then you want to have 20 minutes of sweating after sweating has begun. So usually it's a 30-minute sauna. In the same way, I just thought of something I wanted to say about oxygen therapy. The first time you do it, I usually do an hour, make sure they don't get blurry vision or any other signs of, you know, O2 toxicity on the retina. And they ventilate deeply, but they don't really get the effect because the muscles on the intercostal aspect of the ribs are weak. And so when you do oxygen for a couple of days, the muscles get stronger, they ventilate better. And usually I'll have them do a little bit of exercise to drive the oxygen deeper and tell them to use the bottom third of their lungs, which people don't usually do. So I say take 2 deep breaths and then relax and do like 4 or 5 or 6 regular breaths. If they take too many deep breaths, they'll hyperventilate and get dizzy. Anyway, back to sauna. You should basically do sauna supplements after the sauna is going for a week or two. And that includes niacin, 1/2 tablet, which is 50 milligrams. And they should try that away from the sauna first to see if they can handle the flush. If they can tolerate 50 milligrams in the sauna, then they go up to 100, 200, 300. And we found with the Gulf War study that was being done that the niacin is the most efficacious aspect of the supplements that help with sauna therapy. So the idea is you get increased lipolysis from the niacin, and you get this flushing effect, which helps people to sweat. Then in the sauna box, which has 9 slots, I get it from Vitacost, and it's a big rectangle like this, and I add vitamin C, alpha lipoic acid, minerals, milk thistle, and NAC. And you can add other supplements that you think will enhance detoxification, like calcium, D-glucarate, etc. So what you do is you get used to these supplements, make sure they're okay, and then you add them at the beginning of sauna. And at the end of sauna, you do a scoop of psyllium in a glass of water, flush it down with another glass of water, and you can have oil, 2 tablespoons of an organic oil, and they should be rotated. Every day that you do sauna, you can have a different oil, like avocado or pumpkin or fish or sunflower, safflower, coconut. And you can think of other oils that you would like to have. Make sure they're not rancid when you have them. And then I say about an hour later, then you can do your binders, because the binders will bind your supplements, so you don't want to take them at the same time. So the idea would be to have charcoal, clay, cholestyramine, potentially, mixed together in water, drink it up, and that can be at the time of a meal. Do not eat a large meal before getting in the sauna, ideally, because your liver will have to work on the meal, and you want the liver to be working on your toxins. Ideally, you may do sauna for a couple of years if you've been very ill, get your body used to detoxification, and then when you have problems and you start to get weak and fatigued again, remember to go back to oxygen and go back to sauna.